Again, everybody, and welcome to session four of the World Religions and Health series on Hinduism. And I want to say that this is a particularly special one because the two speakers you'll have tonight were involved in the shaping of the series in general before we even had it last year. Last year was our first year, and Dr. Menon, who will speak second, was one of the first people that I approached asking if he would speak on Hinduism. And he proceeded to say he'd be happy to do that, but he has a couple other people who he'd love to suggest. And he introduced me to Dr. Sarath Menon back there, who spoke last year, spoke beautifully last year, and Rajiv Varma, who will speak first tonight. Rajiv then proceeded to suggest Dr. Harsh Chandra, who's also back there and who also spoke last year. But more importantly, or as importantly, was how they shaped the idea of what we should talk about in this series and how in examining these different religions, we had to sort of get outside of our framework, that we couldn't just see the religious beliefs in terms of our own beliefs, but that, you know, particularly with the Eastern religions and Hinduism for tonight, that, you know, it requires expanding our way of looking at things and considering the term religion even in a different context, and the term health in a different context. And so I'm really happy to finally actually have these two speakers, Rajiv Varma and Dr. Menon, here tonight. Rajiv is a wonderful guy to work with, and he's helped us on a lot of different initiatives. He's an IT consultant by profession. That's not what he's here to speak to you on tonight. He's really active in the Hindu community, intellectually and socially, organizing debates and symposia, and facilitating position papers, all towards the advancement of human empowerment. And he's the vice president of the Hindu Heritage Foundation. He's also an advisor to the Friends of India International Organization and the Hindu Temple of New Orleans, as well as numerous other Buddhist and Hindu and Indian American organizations, and a mentor to many. And through all these experiences, he's accrued vast expertise as to the history, beliefs, practices, texts, and everything that you're about to hear about Hinduism. So. Please warmly welcome Rajiv Varma.
Thank you, Silas.
Can everybody hear me back there?
Okay.
Excellent. And the timer starts. So I'm glad to be here. I really appreciate ISH, Dr. Graham, and Cyrus, and Stuart to give me this opportunity, and Dr. Menon, who introduced me to ISH. It's a pleasure being here, and I'll start with a greeting, Namaste, and this is a Hindu greeting. That means I bow to the spirit in you all, so Namaste. Today is also special, extra special, because this duration, I'm observing a spiritual practice of fasting for 9 days, and that is in the honor of Mother Goddess. So this is a 9-day fast, and there are, you know, other rituals that, you know, we have to do. So to all the ladies especially, one more Namaste. And of course, the goddesses are much harder to please, right? So, Hinduism is a complex subject. Let's accept that, you know. And it may sound different, but it's not really that different. So, since this subject is so vast, and I'm glad my timer is on, it's like taking all the water of the world, like oceans and, you know, all the lakes, rivers, and what have you, and compressing it in this bottle. Okay, that's what I'm going to do in the next 30 minutes or so. 35 minutes. But come to think of it, if you were to know about water, don't you think this bottle is good enough? Maybe 80%? If you want to know how the water looks like in Arctic Ocean, if I give you the hint in this bottle of water, that should be good enough, right? Maybe 70-80%, and then you can do your own exploration later. So it's not really that hard. So thanks for the wonderful introduction, Cyrus. So this is the charter that I was given by ISH. These are some of the questions that I was asked by Cyrus there. Okay, this is what we have to cover. I said, okay. And the way these questions are framed, this is a framework issue that I will go over very briefly, but this is one of the complexities of explaining Hinduism, is that we try to answer it in a framework that the question that is being asked could be different, and it could be answered differently. But I have to do justice to this charter. So it may look like I'm trying to fit a round peg in a square hole or otherwise, but this is what I will attempt to do. So my point is that I'm going to stick to the charter and not go out of it. So religion, like if you take a religion class in college or elsewhere, see on the left hand column, this is what your instructor or teacher teaches you, and these are the six different parameters that are used in defining religion. So one is epistemology, like doctrine of knowledge. Another is ontology, that's doctrine of reality. And forgive me if I'm going too fast, because I have to cover a lot of material, but in case if you think I'm going too fast, please do interrupt. Theology, that's doctrine of God or gods. Cosmology, doctrine of universe. Psychology, that is doctrine of mind. And soteriology, I cannot pronounce that right, but that's doctrine of salvation. Now, I have tried to match it with what terms I'm familiar with, within the Hindu spiritual system. So there is this concept called, and I'm going to speak a lot of Sanskrit, I'll use a lot of Sanskrit names because that's the language that is used. So please bear with me, but it is there on your handout. So there is this concept of Praman Vichar. Praman means proof. So one of the defining features of Hinduism is that everything requires proof. Nothing is given. And there are methods to acquire that proof, which we'll go into that later. But Praman Vichar. Vichar means thought. So this is a thought of, Praman means thoughts of proof. Tattva Vichar, which is elements of existence. Our existence here on this planet. Ishwar Vichar, which basically gods and goddesses. So the spiritual practice I mentioned, it's basically to goddess Durga. That's my favorite goddess. So I go through this discipline of reaching out to Mother Durga. So that's a Devi. Devi means goddess. The English terms actually do not closely match with these terms, but since we are using this language, I'm going to stick to English terms. But they do not translate well. So I will use the word goddess, but what I mean is Devi. And for God, Devata. So Ishwar Vichar. So the thoughts of Ishwara, that's one of the parameters. Then there is one Jagad Vichar, which means the universal existence. There's another one, Jeeva Vichar, that means individual existence. Who am I? And there is finally the Moksha Vichar, that means the thought of liberation. And we'll go into some of it, some in detail, some just one-liner, because it's just too much material to cover. Now, this is the most important part of my presentation. So I want you all to kind of actually blank out your mind first and then listen to me, please, if you could. Because this is what explains, you know, that kernel or the core of Hinduism, what this is. And it goes a bit into epistemology, and which means nature of knowledge. So if necessary, I will even repeat this, but this is the most important part of my presentation. So what is epistemology? That means nature of knowledge. So if you look at the scientific world, which means physical sciences, natural sciences. By the way, I try to put that figure that you see is the universe. So, and it did not come out right, but you can see this, this portion is the universe with all the planets and galaxies and everything in it. So, this is the, or by the way, another is, I put the universes, and I'll tell you later why I have put that plural in there. This is the universe, and if you want to study the universe, what do you do? Which discipline do you use? Physics. Physics, chemistry, astronomy, biology, you know, all of it. And you use those subjects to study the universe, right? Now, from that point of view, from a, what I call is a materialistic point of view, because universe is measured in time and space, it has to end somewhere, right? Maybe we cannot reach it. Maybe the fastest space shuttle cannot reach it, but it, because we are measuring, it has to end somewhere. And this is where I use this term, the edge of the universe. So your physics, chemistry, biology, astronomy stops at this thing called edge of the universe. Fair enough? Right? Feel free to disagree. The way I do this is more conversational. I would love to have one of you or all of you say, hey, this is, you know, I don't understand this, and then I can explain it. So you agree, right? The physics stops at the edge of the universe. There is no physics beyond that. You cannot measure, right? So or the translation of the Hindu philosophy, this universe or universes is manifest reality. This is reality, right? You see the sun, moon, you're on the earth, and you have planets, galaxies, you have a Hubble telescope, you know, looking at things. So this is what is known as manifest. This is manifestation. Now there is another thing, unmanifest reality. The reason to use these two terms, and Sanskrit terms are different, but you know, again, since we are using the English language, so manifest reality and unmanifest reality. The manifest reality is that obviously you can see exists, you can measure in time and space, but there is another reality that has not manifested itself. Let's assume that. The aggregate of these two, MR, UMR, manifest reality and unmanifest reality, is what is known as satya. That means truth. Any issue with that? Because if there is truth there, it has to be aggregate of these two. What is manifest and what is not manifest. That is the truth. And this truth transcends the edge of the universe. See, for this truth, this edge of the universe doesn't exist because it transcends. That means it goes beyond the edge of the universe. You cannot have edge of the universe there for this truth. And this ultimate reality, in English language, I call it just integral knowledge. And in Sanskrit, it's called the Veda. And you must have heard the term Vedic. So Veda is that knowledge that is both the aggregate of what is manifest and what is yet to be manifested. An aggregate of both is the Veda. So because this is the most important, I'm willing to go over it one more time. If any of you is kind of confused or didn't make any sense. But I do want to, you know, have you think of this independent of anything else you know. You know, just this slide. Anything that you don't agree with or you have any doubt on or whatever I said, it's very simple to understand, actually. Yeah.
So what then is the difference between the truth and the integral knowledge?
Same thing.
Okay.
I just use the English word to say.
Okay.
So the satya, that is truth, which is integral knowledge, and which is, in Hindu philosophy, is Veda.
Okay.
Veda means, literally means knowledge. So this slide is clear, right? Now we can define what is Hinduism and who is a Hindu. So just like physics was used, or physics, chemistry, astronomy, biology, is the discipline of study of the universe, material universe, what is the discipline of studying the satya, that satya? Hinduism. Simple.
Yeah.
The discipline of gaining access to satya or the truth is Hinduism. It is as simple as that. It couldn't get more simple than that. And whoever pursues this knowledge is a Hindu. Alright? Now let's go to the explanation. So these two slides were basically the core of what is Hinduism presentation. The rest is all explanation, how everything fits together, and so on. So of course I give the detailed definition. So Hinduism is a culture, it's not a religion, it's a cultural system which encapsulates a unique matrix of multitudes of methods, practices, and traditions with the purpose of acquisition of integral knowledge and the common aim of an inquest into the true nature of reality that may transcend material and non-material. That is most important, the last phrase, that may transcend. And one who pursues this knowledge is Hindu. And Hinduism, by its architecture, is antithetical to classical religion. And you know, classical religion is what it is. However, a big however, and we'll go a little bit into history. I did not want to go history for history's sake, but for me to explain why Hinduism has become a religion, I have to go into a little bit of history. So, however, Hinduism current, as it exists today, has acquired religion-like attributes. So just now, I mean, you would think that, hey, this guy is contradicting himself, right? Just now he said that it's not a religion, now he says it's a religion today. And both are true. And that's the contradiction that I will try to explain. Yeah. So it has acquired attributes. And this is basically the one-line definition down there. Now, so this is a comparison. I'm going to skip a lot of it because there is not enough time. But the Western scientific method that is based on, it's a pretty well defined that, you know, you have to measure, you have to observe, you have to, you know, put together a hypothesis, and then you have to prove it. That method is actually in tune with Hinduism. It's exactly the same. And the reason I'm putting this Western science there, because it helps explain the spiritual processes. Now it is, the nature of reality is different, but the process is the same, more or less. In Hinduism, there is no separation of physical and metaphysical. In other systems, you have, you know, religion versus science. That contradiction doesn't exist here. Both are one and the same. You know, there's no difference between science and religion. Religion is science, science is religion. With the assumption that Hinduism is a religion, but still, there is no separation between the two. Now, Now that knowledge acquisition part is set as in the definition, let us define a very important term called dharma. You must have heard the term dharma, right? Dharma in abstraction, it's a very complex term because there is no English equivalent to it. Nobody has ever translated this into the English language. One that holds. Anything that holds is dharma. So, what is the dharma of the solar system? Gravity. If the gravity is not there, the planets are not, you know, there won't be any solar system, right? So this knowledge that a seeker is seeking, there are two types of knowledge. One is informative, other is transformative. Informative is let us say within the Western scientific framework, because if you are observing an object, even though you know, you will say that Heisenberg's principle, right? Because you cannot measure an entity without affecting it, that applies here. But let us say you are doing in a physics experiment, you are basically gaining a knowledge, that is, you are being informed of that knowledge. Okay? In this knowledge acquisition, the student or the seeker is part of the knowledge. So that is a very important difference. You know, going back to this diagram, because you are sitting inside this and you are seeking the knowledge of itself, so you are also part of that. So when you acquire this knowledge, you are basically discovering yourself. That's what self-realization is. What is your true nature? So when you acquire this knowledge, you are getting closer to that. So this knowledge acquisition is transforming you. And this culmination of this knowledge acquisition is, I know these are very familiar terms, I'm going to skip a lot of them, like enlightenment. So what is enlightenment, by the way? In enlightenment, you are not gaining anything new. You are just shedding your ignorance. You know, when you say, I'm enlightened, that means you haven't gained anything new. There was some ignorance, you have just shed that. And then you know your true self. It's also called moksha or liberation. And what dharma is, that dharma is the way to acquire knowledge and get closer to the truth. So this is an important aspect or qualification for dharma. You know, not everything can qualify under dharma. Dharma is only that enables you or facilitates you getting closer to the satya or the truth. That's dharma. There is another term called sanatan dharma. So there's a lot of confusion, you know, when people say that Hinduism is not a religion, it is Sanatan Dharma. That equation is not correct. There is a Sanatan Dharma. So what is the reference to what is Sanatan? Sanatan means eternal. Remember, Dharma is something that holds. So what is eternal Dharma? That is always valid. And I'll give you an example, because this is a very vast topic. You know, you can spend like years on this. One of the examples is, there's a concept of RTA, Rita. Rita means cosmic order. And what is this cosmic order? Again, it goes back to that table, it goes back to cosmology. That means cyclical creation. That means the universe manifests or it gets created, it lives, and it gets dissolved, and the cycle continues. That's cosmology, elementary cosmology. And there is this concept of, there is no one universe. There is a concept of multiverses. How many universes are recognized? 14. So this is one of them, and there are 13 more. But those, it will take quite some time to explain, you know, all of those. So there is no universe, there is multiverses, multiple universes. And that is Sanatan Dharma, because that's valid all the time. Then there are other dharmas. You know, what is your dharma as a family man? You know, you have to go back and make sure your kids have done homework, right? So parivar dharma, purush dharma, stri dharma, women's dharma, children's dharma, anything that holds any of this. There is also a political dharma that's called Raj dharma. And these are very well defined concepts. And I'm hopelessly out of time. Okay, I have to rush. Karma, that's another concept. And you must have heard this term. Karma is basically, action and deeds. So keep in mind that diagram that I showed you. So the locus standi or the position of karma in that is that it is the karma that facilitates that of getting closer to the truth. If you do good karma, you get closer. If you do bad karma, you move away. And to explain this karma principle, this nature of man, or what does the, well, you know, to be correct, nature of human, I wrote man. So there are four dimensions to every human. One is the Sanskrit, I'll skip the Sanskrit names. This is basically body, mind, intellect, and soul. This equation is, Atma is soul, soul is Atma. There is some dispute over that. But we'll just keep it simple, we'll call it soul. So body, mind, intellect, and soul, these are the four dimensions of every human. Where Atma is sovereign, the soul is sovereign, body is just like clothing. And at death, it is just a change of clothes for the Atma. You die, you go to the next one. So this is the last line, this is what the equation, the life one, birth one, this birth, death, and then life two, birth, death. And the cycle continues. Suffering is caused by past bad deeds, but then do good deeds today so you do not suffer in the future. So this karma principle is actually valid only if you recognize the concept of rebirth. If due to whatever reason, if you say that there is only one life, then this principle of karma actually becomes very atrocious. Because in this life, whatever your suffering is, you're saying that, something happened back, whenever, and I'm suffering because of that. But if you don't have any life to look forward to, then you are not going to, you have no incentive to do good deeds, right? So the important thing is that this karma principle applies only to multiple, the cycle of rebirth. Otherwise, it does not. So now we have defined what is knowledge acquisition, we have defined the dharma and karma, because these are the tools or the phenomena that is used in acquiring that knowledge. This is from the Hindu point of view. These are recommendations for this seeker, the student. Now, some of the times in literature, they say that, this is a requirement. This is actually not a requirement. Nobody is forcing you to comply to this. But since you are a student, and if you are sitting in my class, I may impose some, I'm teaching you physics class. I will not let you come in this class with a beer bottle, right? Because there are certain rules of studying physics. This is the same concept. If your Atma is doing knowledge acquisition, you need to have this kind of discipline to actually approach that or do justice. The only difference here is that your lifetime, this life, is only a class period. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 8 to 8:50. 8 o'clock you take birth, 8:50 you pass away, and then you go to the next period. So this is the only difference. That's why there are so many, you will see that there are so many requirements and all of that. Chaturvidha purusharthas, there are four aims of life: dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. So the right path, ways and means, if you don't do a job, you're not going to get a paycheck, right? Kama, desire, including sex, right? If there is no sex, there is no procreation, and there is no satisfaction. I'll talk about Kama Sutra just in a minute here. And moksha means liberation. And there are four stages of life that are recommended. One is student, householder, retired, and renunciate. So student and householder, you know, it's pretty simple. But there comes a stage where you want to give up possessions. You know, you will see sometimes there's 80-year-old men marrying 20-year-old women, right? So that kind of culture, this is not that kind of culture. You enjoy life, you enjoy your knowledge, you know, your student life in acquiring skills. Householder, you enjoy your marital life, but then start giving up. That is why this is the way this is laid out. These are the milestones in it. So the entire life is a spiritual life because this is knowledge acquisition. I'm actually going to skip all of this. This is in your, and some of this is very, trivial to understand. But these are the milestones. It's called 16 sanskaras. Actually, not every Hindu goes through all of this, by the way. There has been cultural attrition. So one is like conception, another baby shower, Simanta, the third one. Keep the pregnant woman happy. There are, rituals and all of that. Rest of it is pretty trivial to understand. There's no time for all this. See, these are some of the spiritual methods that are available. Foremost is Murti Puja, you translate into English, it's called idol worshipping. A lot of Hindus get defensive about it. Even some sects of Hinduism discard it. And this is a history, behind that. But idol worshipping or Murti Puja is like taking an arithmetic class. Remember, you are now doing knowledge acquisition. So how do you study calculus? Do you straight away jump into that? You have to study arithmetic first, right? Then you go to algebra and then calculus. So I find it very amusing when people start saying that they want to practice yoga, but they don't want to get into Murti Puja. So I tell them that, look, boss, if you want to do calculus without doing arithmetic, good luck. There is also cow worshipping. Now, of course, this is, the environment we are in, we are like a steak culture, right? But this is a valid form of a spiritual method. Gau Puja is called, it's cow worshipping, and cow is considered a devi or equivalent of. That means it's a deity. And I'll come back to it. Then there is fasting, like right now I'm on 9-day fast, so that's one of the methods. There's a fire ritual. They're listening to spiritual stories and meditation, you may have heard, yoga, and dance. The Indian dance, the purpose of Indian dance is same as this Murti Puja. What you go through in that process, similarly you go through dancing. So you can dance your way to knowledge acquisition. There are all kinds of literatures available. Maybe a million manuscripts now, in Sanskrit. But there are two types, and this is very important to explain. And I hope you give me 5 more minutes beyond my time. One is Shruti, what is discovered. Just like, let me try to explain Shruti, what it is. So law of gravity, when Newton sat under the apple tree, he observed the apple falling down, right? The apple did not go up. So he discovered a law. Same thing in a spiritual sense, or the spiritual world, is Shruti. That's all. The same concept. And then there is the Smriti, which is the memoirs. You can say those are somebody's spiritual experiences, they record it in a memoir. So Shruti is always an oral tradition, and it's oral not because people didn't know how to write or because that is the nature of that knowledge, that once you put it in writing or It's called reducing to writing. And the reason these were reduced to writing, because there was a danger of getting lost. So that's why they came to paper, and then of course now to the internet through that mechanism. But that's an oral tradition that is actually, you know, chanted, and there is a way to chant. And these were memorized since the thousands of years, and they were passed down the generations. The recorded Shruti is the Vedas. So that those spiritual laws that we talked about earlier. There are two portions of Vedas. One is collection of mantra. So, and other is commentary. I'm not going to go into commentary. But what is a mantra? You must have heard this term mantra, right? So any Matrix fans? Everybody is Matrix fan, right? Remember, they do something to reach to the soft or the other world, right? This is something similar to that. So mantra, when chanting, it gains access to another world. That's what it is. As simple, it's beautifully explained in the Matrix, the movie. And then there is verse, song, prose. I'm going to skip all of that. The Smriti, that means memoirs, are so many, like Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is a very important one, only because it encapsulates a lot of this in a very concise form, and there is a context to it. And then Ayurveda is code of living and well-being, and Dr. Menon will cover that. This is what is the Hindu ecosystem. Remember, this knowledge acquisition is happening. Now, knowledge acquisition, you need a certain ecosystem to make that happen. And these are like the festivals. And I'll go over, these are different festivals and fairs, very simple to understand. But I'll go over two festivals. One is Raksha Bandhan. And the other is Karwa Chauth. Now, festivals are so many. And like every different part of India, different community, we'll have different variations, so even the names will not match. But what this does is, it cements the bond between brothers and sisters. That's what it's doing. And husband and wife, that the other festival. There are so many others. Let's move on. This is the family, community, society, and the state. There are different pointers. So I put the Hindu nuclear family. So the mother is a proton, daughter is a neutron, son and dad are the electrons rotating always, the nucleus. And that is true. Our culture, or Hindu culture, is female driven, always. Doesn't matter if the both of them are working, that's fine. In fact, there are verses in Rig Veda actually, that a man's job is to get the paycheck home. That means, you know, there's a different language, but to get the paycheck home and put everything on the hands of the wife. Does not mean you can take $5 from there, no. So if you have to drink beer out of that, then you have to beg like 100 times I don't know how to close that. My time is up. So this is basically a female-driven like social system where, you know, the rules are set, you know, and all of this is geared towards, again, knowledge acquisition. That means this is also an ecosystem where that can happen. And we have this joint family system. Even though a lot of attrition has happened, but last year I visited a family in rural India. There were 60 people in a family living in the same house. And no discord whatsoever. And who ran that household? The grandmother. And the kitchen was the sent headquarters. And everything ran smoothly. 60 people. And men had their own dhow houses, you know, here and there. But everything was smooth there. The Hindu culture also has this jati system, which is caste system. There's a lot of controversy over this. I'll not go into that, I can speak for hours on that, but jati system is a very integral part of Hinduism. The reason is that it is the It facilitates tradition. Keep in mind, I'm going to jump ahead. Why that tradition is important, I actually list it here. Flow of authority. The first authority is from literature, second is from tradition, third is intuition. There's no, we don't have, Hinduism does not have any system of pope or bishops or mullah or rabbi or, you know, if you have a problem, you go to your grandma, that's it. Yeah. Well, this is the flow of authority. So most of this is carried through a tradition, and jatis are the carriers of that tradition, and that's why they are important. Now, due to colonialism and, you know, other factors, you know, there are some issues that have come up, and you can explain that. There is another concept called Varna Shram Dharma. This is a fourfold classification. So we have the Brahmins, the Kshatriyas, the Vaishyas, and the Shudra. So Brahmins are the teachers. Because this is a knowledge system, somebody has to teach it, right? But to keep up the Hindu ecosystem, you have to have its defenders. Otherwise, you know, the barbarians will always be at the gates, right? So somebody has to defend. Now somebody has to run the economics of it. So these three classes, you know, they have their own extra spiritual activity, because all this is happening in the spiritual realm. Okay, there's no difference between secular and you know, non-secular. So everybody has to do their you know, bit, and the principle here is of complementarity. That means everybody complements their roles. Nobody is superior or inferior. Ethics and morality. This is a very important part to explain. In the traditional religion, where does the morality come from, or the source of it? Commandments, right? Thou shalt not do this, you know. So it has a system. In Hinduism, and let me build the context to it. So you all have heard of Kama Sutra. It has been presented as a sex manual. And you have different positions. It has homosexuality in it, how to have anal sex. It has a lot of stuff like that. But it's not a sex manual, or the way it is presented here. It is a book of spirituality, and let me explain. The sage who wrote Kama Sutra, he wrote it as a book of spirituality, and this is why. Because the system of spirituality, he recognized that sex is an integral part of a human's desire. And if somebody is like, if you want to do neurosurgery, and you know, if you are stuck in this, you know, in the desire, maybe you cannot do neurosurgery well. So he said that let's devise a way so that to fulfill the sexual needs of that student, he devised all this manual, this whole gamut of what is known as Kama Sutra. So it's like if you do neurosurgery, if you learn, I'm just using this example, you may have a prerequisite course. Maybe you cannot do neurosurgery without doing this. And Kama Sutra is nothing but that. It's a prerequisite. That you do this, satisfy all your carnal pleasures, and then go to the next stage where there is the pleasure is 1,000 times more. And that's the spiritual pleasure. And that's why Kama Sutra was written. Now somebody tell me, who will go and take this prerequisite course offered at University of Houston just for the heck of taking that course? No, right? So Kama Sutra is meant only for those people who are in that discipline of spirituality. It's not meant for everybody. And you cannot even do those asanas because it's very, you know, it's very difficult to do those. So all this, you know, novelty of, Indians have written a sex manual and, you know, pornography and this, people don't understand that. No. Okay, I think Cyrus is hinting at something. One of the things that the point that I was trying to make is Kama Sutra also has a method how to entice your friend's wife. Okay? Now remember, commandment says thou shalt not covet your neighbor's wife. Here this sage is specifically putting it in that spiritual book. What does that mean? Because the flow of, or the source of morality, it's not scripture. Or it's not a book. And he wants to put it specifically there because he doesn't want anybody to follow that book as a source of morality. So what is the source of morality in Hinduism? It's your practice. And it's very, very simple to understand. The more you know the truth, the more moral you are. I don't need to have a pope, bishop, or an inquisition, or any of those instruments to make you moral. Simple. You practice spirituality, and the more you get closer to the truth, the more moral you are. And through this system, maybe you can get 80% of it, you know, in a population. And then the rest 20%, then you have your law enforcement and, you know. So it's the classical version of libertarianism, right? Small government. But you have the methods. Okay, I'm going to skip all of that. I do wanted to cover the yoga, but these are different schools of philosophies. There is a Astika, there are two categories of philosophy. It's called darshana. Darshana means to see. So philosophy is to inform, but darshana is to transform. So these are different ways to for that knowledge acquisition, and these are too just vast to even go into that. The important point is that there has always been a culture of debates. That means you debate me, I debate you. And Buddhists, even though Buddhists today is a separate religion, but you cannot really discuss Hinduism without discussing Buddhism. And it's a too vast a topic. But this is one of the Nastika darshanas. And the difference between Nastika and Astika I'm giving there. Astika is someone who finds the Vedic knowledge authoritative. And Nastika is someone who does not consider Vedic knowledge authoritative. That's the only difference. So Nastika is keep doing your practice. And this is what Buddhist and Jaina practices are. Let's just skip all of this. This is theology, that God. You have heard these terms, one God, monotheistic, multiple gods, polytheistic, no god, atheistic, right? None of these categories fit Hinduism. There is a concept of devis and devatas, there's Ishvara, there's Brahman. Brahman, that's absolute truth, but Ishvara is not the same as Brahman. And in Nastika Darshana, that means Buddhist, Jaina, and this Lokaya tradition, it doesn't exist anymore, by the way, but it is pure materialism. It says, eat, live, be merry, you know, spend your life, you know, in material pursuits, you're fine. But that is a Nastika darshana as well. Okay. Yoga philosophy, I wanted to cover, but there's no time. Maybe I can come back to it in question and answer, but let's just move on. Okay. The origins, because this question was asked, the origins of Hinduism, it is Bharat, which means that the name of India is Bharat. The question is why? Why the importance of India? Actually, I couldn't scan a better copy. So I have a map, but I'll just pass it around after I, you know, present. So in that you will see, in this map you will not see the names of big metros or Mumbai or, you know. These are all spiritual places. And this is the best way to explain this. These are the equivalent of Oxford and Cambridge and Harvard and MIT of the spiritual world. That's why this place is important. Not just because it was originated there. It's because even today, after all of this, you have the masters, spiritual masters. These places have sanctity, pilgrimage sites, temples. That's why this is important. Now, this could go somewhere. Maybe America can become one of, you know, like this one, maybe later. But this is what's today. Then this is why this is important. This is a historical timeline. I wanted to explain how modern Hinduism came into being, or that acquired these attributes of religion. I'll skip this because it's very intuitive, because there was a lot of invasions. This is the backdrop of the birth of modern Hinduism. And this is also, you can just read it on your own. The modern Hinduism came as a response to colonialism, because 1800 to 1857, this was the most stressful time for India and the Hindu population there. Just 2 more minutes. The British colonialists, of course, today British are the most liberal people, but British colonialists had this plan of doing what they did to in the US or New Zealand or Australia or everywhere else. Not because they were bad people, because they seriously believed in the superiority of the white race. You know, craniometry, that was one of the the Jim Crow societies, and you know, all of that. This was all connected, by the way. So they were going to do exactly the same in India. And in that condition, somebody rose up saying that, okay, let's do something about it. So I'm not going to go into the details. The important point here is, and you can just read it, this portion here, because there's some compromises were made from the Hindu end. And they said that, okay, Brahman, which you know, you it was listed earlier, is God, and Jesus was taken as the holy man, and this philosophy of Advaita Vedanta was interpreted as monotheism. So remember, from the colonial point of view, because the British came and say that, oh, I am superior because I am monotheist. So the Indian said, oh yeah, you are monotheist? No, I am the real monotheist. That exactly, this is exactly what happened. And so it was a defensive mechanism, and this was internalized, and you know, one of the defining moment of this was, there was this World Parliament of Religions that was held at Chicago at 1893. And this is how this the monk's name who represented Hinduism was Swami Vivekananda. And this is how he negotiated his place at the table. Remember, these are the two factions. So, of course, I did not go into that. But he said the Hindu representative was not invited to that, because they said that you are not a religion. So he said that, oh, what do you mean? I'm a religion. And please give me a chance to come and participate in your parliament of religions. So in that, this acquired these attributes. So the important point is, that it is when a Hindu expresses it, he expresses it in the form of a religion. Like somebody comes to me and says, do you believe in God? I said, yeah, I believe in God. Because what I want to do, I want to get rid of that guy. So it's in the expression that it has become a religion. Otherwise, at homes, and you know, we practice the way this has been practicing for thousands of years. So that was my presentation. Of course, there was not enough time, but thanks a lot. Thanks to Cyrus for listening, giving me time. Thank you.